The next session is on global antitrust issues, or antitrust global issues. My name's Lisl Dunlop. I'm a partner at Manatt, Phelps. I've been involved in international antitrust for many years, not least of which I participated in the ABA section of antitrust laws international task force, which I'm sure we'll hear about at some point during the day here, where we review and comment on changes, proposed changes to antitrust laws and regulations across the globe. So I was very interested to be asked to join this program and review these three very different and interesting papers that we've got to look at today. So, you know, just to give you five minutes of context, as most of you probably know, there's been a huge explosion of jurisdictions that have some form of antitrust law over the last, say, 10 years. If you look at the stats in 1990, there were fewer than 20 jurisdictions having some form of antitrust law, and you come to today and there's about 120 jurisdictions, maybe more. Rachel might have more up-to-date figures. And, you know, new competition laws continue to come into effect every day. Today, though, we're going to focus on, you know, some of the more established and historical jurisdictions, as well as China, which I think is a newer, you know, the AML's been in place, I think it's 10-year anniversary this year, isn't it? Something like that.
Of enactment.
You know, over the years, there's been a lot of discussion about convergence in terms of principle. And I think that there are some significant, consensus around some of the core principles that antitrust rests on. And we'll hear about one example of that being market definition from Viktoria. But there are obviously enormous differences in approach, both from a social and cultural perspective, as well as different procedural models and just other kind of political and other issues that come into play when competition authorities and courts apply competition laws. So we've got a full schedule for you today. We're dealing with three papers, just to briefly kind of explain how we're going to run it. We'll hear from each of the academics who wrote papers first, followed by their academic discussant, and then a short comment by a practitioner discussant, who would be either me or my colleague Alanna Rutherford, who is a partner from Boies, Schiller, who focuses on antitrust and complex civil litigation, mainly here in the US. And then at the conclusion of all three of the papers, we'll go to Rachel Brandenburger, who brings us a multifaceted perspective, both as a practitioner, government enforcer, and academic through her work through Oxford University, who will kind of look back and give overall comments on the entire spectrum of papers that we've heard from today. So I'll get down and I'll hand over to Wendy.
Hi, everyone. First of all, thank you to NYU and the ABA for inviting me to attend this conference and to present my paper. Now, in the course of economic reform, China has introduced market principles and mechanisms into the Chinese economy whilst remaining committed to a socialist system, which includes having a socialist market economy and a socialist legal system. My interest is in finding out how market principles and socialist principles interact together to regulate markets in China from a legal perspective. And my paper examines this question by looking at one of the principal laws that regulate markets in China, which is its competition law called the anti-monopoly law, or the AML. First, I must make it clear that I do not engage in the debates or discussions relating to normative conceptions of socialism and whether or not China remains consistent with or has transformed the concept of socialism by adopting market principles. China absolutely views itself as a socialist state with economic and legal systems that are socialist in nature. Thus, what I do is use China's own understanding of socialism and look at its implications for competition law. So, what is China's own understanding of what it means to be a socialist state? I find that there are two principles that are key to socialism in China. First, it's the leadership of the party. This means it's regarded as the most essential feature of socialism with Chinese characteristics. It means that the party, through various mechanisms, is deeply involved in, has authority and control over, and supervises state affairs and state institutions. And the second feature is the dominance of public ownership, and it is the foundation of China's socialist economic system. Of course, having a strong single party, state ownership, or state involvement in the economy, they're not features that are unique or distinct to China or socialism, but they are regarded by China itself to be fundamental to its own approach to socialism. So I wanted to examine how these two key principles of socialism with Chinese characteristics might influence markets and their legal regulation. Now, in practical terms, what does this mean? These two principles are reflected in the market in two ways. One is that the state is a direct participant in the market, and mainly through its state-owned enterprises, or SOEs. And the second is that the state, the economy is subject to the macroeconomic regulation and control of the state. So therefore, the introduction of market principles in the Chinese economy whilst remaining committed to key socialist principles means that the state has two roles in the market. It is both a direct participant and a regulator. So that I then explore how these two roles of the state influence how the anti-monopoly law is understood and enforced in China. So first, I look at the state roles as a direct participant in the market. How has the AML been applied to state-owned enterprises? Well, first of all, contrary to some concerns at the very beginning, the AML has been applied to SOEs. It's been applied against both centrally owned SOEs and locally owned SOEs, SOEs operating in industries where they're the main or dominant players, and also industries where SOEs compete with private businesses. However, I do observe that there are three, that this enforcement has been characterized by three features. First is that more enforcement action has been taken against locally owned SOEs than centrally owned SOEs. That the investigation of SOEs are like more likely to result in settlement than financial sanctions than investigations involving private enterprises, and that merger enforcement activity involving SOEs seems to be disproportionately low. So what might explain these enforcement dynamics? I argue that they reflect some of the institutional and political constraints that competition agencies face when they are seeking to enforce the AML against SOEs. Now, these constraints arise from the fact that SOEs, apart from being state-owned or state-controlled, they are also part of the political structure. So what are these constraints? Well, first, SOEs that are more likely to attract scrutiny under the anti-monopoly law, they tend to be larger, more economically powerful, and they tend to operate in strategic or important industries. So therefore, these SOEs are themselves economically and politically powerful actors in the political economy. Second, SOEs might have the support of industry regulators who are there themselves key players within the areas of regulatory power. And in particular, this is likely for centrally owned SOEs because centrally owned SOEs tend to operate in strategic and important sectors that are subject to industry regulation. Now, when it comes to the AML, the SOEs and industry regulators are on the same side because both of them have incentives to oppose or resist AML enforcement, which means that the support of industry regulators adds to the political weight that is opposing or resisting enforcement. And three, a competition agency's ability to enforce the AML against the SOE and its effectiveness in doing so is impacted by their relative positions and power within the administrative and political hierarchy. And this is shaped by the bureaucratic ranking system. The political power that is wielded by a government or party institution is determined by its own bureaucratic rank and the rank of its leaders within that system. And this in turn shapes the interactions between them. So the Chinese competition agencies, they are all ministries, and so they have ministry level rank. However, the actual enforcement work is done by bureaus within the central level ministry, or they're done by the local offices of these ministries. And these bureaus and local offices, they are ranked at lower than ministry level. On the other hand, SOEs, generally speaking, locally owned SOEs are ranked lower and have less political power than centrally owned SOEs, and centrally owned SOEs can be ranked at the vice ministry or even ministry level. So you can see that there might be a ranking disparity between the competition agency that is doing the enforcement work and the SOE is trying to enforce the law against. So therefore, looking at these political and institutional constraints, I argue in my paper that, one, there has been more enforcement action taken against local SOEs, in part because it's simply politically easier to do so than to take action against centrally owned SOEs. SOE investigations are more likely to result in settlement because it achieves two purposes. One, it harmoniously resolves the political pressures that may be faced by the competition authority from SOEs and other government departments during these investigations. And it also allows the competition agency to address the anti-competitive conduct and deliver some benefits to consumers. And three, merger enforcement activity relating to SOEs has been disproportionately low because the constraints faced by the competition agencies provide SOEs with cover not only not to avoid notifying their mergers for competition review, but it also protects them from being investigated or sanctioned for such non-compliance. Next, I look at the role of the state as a regulator and how that role has influenced the AML and its enforcement. And I observe that there are two aspects of the state's regulatory role that are reflected in the AML. First, the state supervises market activities. And consistent with this, the AML has been used to monitor and supervise prices. Now, one of the competition agencies, the NDRC, views the AML as an instrument of price regulation to help it carry out its role as a price regulator. The NDRC is also using the AML to change its approach to regulation. Now, the NDRC was the state's economic planner, so it has tended to adopt an interventionist approach to solving economic problems. However, it is currently adapting its approach to market regulation to one that is more based on supervision, consistent with the Chinese government's relatively recent clarification of its role in the economy, and the NDRC is using the AML to help it change its regulatory approach. And the AML has also been used to supervise and monitor the conduct of merging parties in the most post-merger period. Now, a majority of the merger conditions that have been imposed by MOFCOM, who is the competition regulator responsible for merger enforcement, they have been behavioural remedies. These merger conditions allow MOFCOM to monitor and supervise the merging parties on an ongoing basis. It helps it to gather information to help it monitor market activity, and it also provides it with the basis to intervene where necessary. Now, unlike a number of other competition agencies, MOFCOM does not have any preference for structural or behavioural remedies. And this is consistent with the administrative culture and practice in China, where administrative agencies are accustomed to supervising and guiding the conduct of private parties, which is why there is no such preference for structural over behavioural. Now, in relation to the second aspect of the state's regulatory role, the AML recognises that in carrying out that role, the state itself also can impede competition, which is why the AML is also used to supervise exercises of administrative power by prohibiting its anti-competitive abuse. And it's also known as administrative monopoly. Now, it does have a relatively weak enforcement mechanism, but the prohibition against administrative monopoly has been increasingly applied since the latter half of 2014. Now, the use of the AML in supervising government activities is consistent with the Chinese government's focus on rebalancing and clarifying the respective roles of the government and the market in the economy. And this is also reflected in the adoption of what we call the fair competition review system. Whereas the AML is an ex post examination of government actions and their competitive impact, the fair competition review system provides for ex ante competition assessment of government regulatory activities. So together, the AML and the fair competition review system help to determine the bounds of appropriate government regulation and intervention in the market. So in conclusion, in China, the adherence to both socialist and market principles means that the state has two roles in the market. They are potentially conflicting roles because it participates and also regulates itself. Both dimensions of the state roles in the economy have shaped the way in which competition law is understood and enforced in China. On the one hand, the enforcement of the AML against state-owned enterprises has been constrained because these SOEs benefit from their position and status within the government and political structures and from their relationships with other government actors. But on the other hand, the AML has been enforced to further the government's supervisory role in the market and to help ensure that its own regulatory interventions are limited. So thank you, and I look forward to any comments you have on the paper. Thanks.
Thanks, Wendy.
Okay, is that better? Yeah, it certainly is, isn't it? Maybe it's worse. First, I want to compliment Wendy for doing something that we rarely encounter in American legal academics, and that is taking China seriously. We do, American legal academics do take China seriously in the sense of the way a doctor would take a patient seriously, or a Mormon missionary would take a non-Mormon seriously, something to improve. There is a very strong missionary zeal when Americans encounter China, and maybe Australians are immune to that. Anyway, I'm very pleased that Wendy's paper deals with China as an object of comparative law, something to learn about, rather than something to improve. So that's the end of the nice comments, and now I'm going to tear it apart. Wendy and I have already talked about this, so she's already addressed some of my concerns, but she says at the bottom of page one, she tries to keep me from saying this at the bottom, you know, the very first paper before we started discussing it over email, and then she does did it again, and I understand why, because this is part of a chapter in a book, and the chapter is what she's supposed to write, and I'm telling her what often happens in academic conferences, that she should be writing the paper that I want to read. And the complaint I have is that there's nothing socialist in this, and when Wendy talks about Chinese socialism and then accepts Chinese definition of socialism as being a Leninist party and a large involvement of public ownership, there's nothing socialist in that. The Nationalist Party in China was the first Asian Leninist party. It was started by the Soviet Union before the Communist Party was. There's nothing socialist in the sense of Marxist or some kind of normative. By taking the normative socialist out of it, I don't know what's left about socialism. Now, let me say, as I said at the very beginning, that just describing China as something of serious interest is extraordinarily important. And that's what Wendy does. So I'm just saying that as she, you know, I'm proposing, I think we decided over lunch that this is further work, right? So the further work would be talking about, is there something about China that is socialist? Not just the Leninist Party, which the Nationalists had. The Japanese had a long time one-party system. There are Pinochet, Park. There are lots of authoritarian, strong, institutionally strong one-party systems that are not socialist. China may be socialist, but just because it's focuses on the Communist Party doesn't make it socialist. It just makes it a strong single-party state. The other thing I'd like to see is whether antitrust or competition or market free market efficiency is good for economic development? And secondly, is it good for development, which is economic growth? And then the second is it good for economic for social and political development. No country that I know of, and I really only know about Japan, I'm an East Asian specialist, that's why I was not an antitrust specialist, if that's not already obvious. Japan, Taiwan, China a little bit, and the United States just by, you know, teaching basic courses here and living here. None of those countries developed with what I think antitrust, at least economically oriented antitrust scholars think are efficient rules. The United States was massively protectionist when it was developing. Japan had all the right market rhetoric when it was growing like Topsy, but it cheated like mad. There were massive government private cartels that controlled the markets. And both those countries were extremely successful. And so has China been. And so I wonder whether what I would like Wendy to do in her next paper is to talk about whether Chinese competition policy is part of the reason that it has grown faster than any other economy, in any other significant economy in human history. And that would be really, it's an important question. And it connects to another question that I have about the paper. This is not a directly comparative paper. She doesn't say, this is what Germany does, this is what the US does, this is what Japan does. But it's referenced. And in the background, the referent are advanced economies. China is not an advanced economy. It's not a mature economy. It shouldn't be compared or referenced to present-day the United States or present-day Australia. It should be referenced to 19th century United States. That's when the United States developed. That's when it was dealing with relatively weak institutions. That's when it was dealing with building up private sector companies within a regulatory system that couldn't be all that good because you didn't have that institutional strength. That's the referent. That's what we should be looking at. And if we want to take China seriously, as I think we absolutely should, as not a model, but as something to learn from. So if you're coming to China from the perspective of Bangladesh or Nigeria or South Africa or Paraguay, you're going to want to know what, in your interest in competition law, you're going to want to know what are the competition law enforcement aspects of Chinese policy that have contributed to economic growth. I don't think you're going to want to know how does it compare to the United States, because the United States is a totally different ballgame. I don't know what the United States antitrust policy could possibly say to someone in India. I mean, I'm sure we say a lot to people in India. We certainly say a lot to people in China. I'm just wondering how useful that is, because the countries are at such different economic stages. So what I want her to do is to talk more about China as an example of a successful developing economy, and less as an iteration with two strong exceptions, or at least one strong exception, to American and other advanced economies. On the one strong exception, she discusses hierarchy and size as being constraints for AML enforcement in China. Size is, you know, GM is hard to take on. Okay, actually, GM's now small, but Google is hard to take on. Facebook is hard to take on. And in terms of hierarchies, we've got that in the United States too. So the issue seems to me that the distinctive issue in China is not that these constraints of size and hierarchy and relative agency strength, it's politics. In the United States, there's political space for agencies or individuals or companies to make waves, serious waves, waves that will rock Xi Jinping's boat, because there's a possibility of political change, fundamental political change. And of course, there's also the negative thing. There's nothing really horrible is going to happen to you. And that political stuff is the other thing that I'd like her to do in the paper that I am suggesting that she write in the future. But that's it. I think it was a great paper, and I enjoyed it, and obviously it engaged me greatly. Thanks.
Thank you, Frank. So, Alanna, a couple of quick practitioner perspective comments.
Quick practitioner comments, actually, though, dovetail nicely with what the Uphamian view of the world is. First, what I found interesting about all the papers was that there seems to be a theoretical agreement across countries and across continents and different market types as to what the antitrust laws should be in theory. Now, the differences are of enforcement are based on usually unique cultural and historical developments of the antitrust laws and places of development, which the Frank Upham's comments highlighted. I thought what was really good about Wendy's paper was that it really showed sort of where China was in terms of its market development and implementation of the antitrust laws and the tension that is engendered by trying to do this sort of slow stage deregulation to a capitalist society while maintaining overall control. For companies that do business in China, I would sort of hand this off and be like, these are some of the obstacles you face in case you want it. But it fulfills the mission statement of the paper. I think as a practitioner, I would want a few other things from it. So I know the playing field now. But for example, there's a point in the paper, probably halfway through, where you discuss some of the enforcement examples, but there's not a lot of detail. I would actually like to see more detail around some of those examples, because I think it would help practitioners understand sort of where you go from enforcing what strictly the AML says to probably the political divergence you need to know, and to understand the differences between that. But that's, you know, really the only comment for what you were trying to do. I think more on the practical side is, I don't know what this says about a company that decides to enter the Chinese market and whether it could compete effectively. Are the antitrust laws simply a tool of protectionism that China uses to make sure it favors its own businesses versus outsiders? Is that the reason why companies like a Facebook can't succeed in China, or that Baidu wins over Google? Or is it just a factor of knowing the local marketplace? So I'm not suggesting that you have to answer that question in this paper, but I'm suggesting that as a practitioner and as somebody who is advising companies on how to operate in markets, that's something that is definitely ringing bells with me. The other thing, and we've discussed this before, my own personal bias is our firm. Some of you may know the In-Re vitamin C, Chinese vitamin C case. There's an aspect of which all antitrust laws are now global. You're enforcing a domestic principle, but that has an effect all around the world for your companies. So this case, which is currently pending before the Supreme Court, is all about whether the Chinese government can say that, oh, no, no, we make them price fix, so we get exemption, or they get exemption from enforcement of American antitrust laws when they do business here. Now, there's some strange things, like since this case, China has changed how they operate their laws overseas as opposed to domestically, so it's sort of a one-off incident, unlikely to repeat itself in exactly the same way. But there's still a question, and it's the same question posed by American businesses doing overseas, and you know, the difference in enforcement mechanism you see between what happens in investigation and prosecutions in the United States versus EU. How do you create a regime that allows businesses to thrive both domestically and overseas, and still live up to the principles of antitrust, which is to encourage competition, because we see that even when we all are in theoretical agreement with the antitrust laws, the reality is we don't enforce it in the same way. We don't come to the same conclusions on implementation. So if you want me to be brief, I'll just stop there.
That's great, Alanna. Thank you very much. So without further ado, we'll move on to our next paper, which is Viktoria Robertson, and into the world of economics and law and market definition and EU-US comparative approach.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm very glad to be here talking about my paper on market definition between law and economics, which is more of a conceptual paper and less of a substantive paper. So let's start right with the paper. In competition law, in many jurisdictions, the relevant market is used as a filter, as a tool to see where we should apply the competition law rules. It's been called a legal construct or a shorthand for a legal requirement. What I'm doing in this paper is not ask what is the relevant market, how do we understand it. I'm asking how do we build the filter? What are the ingredients, so to speak? Is it more law? Is it more economics? It's probably a combination, but to which percentage? And I did that by looking at two perspectives, but you can look at many more. And the ones I chose was the pragmatic perspective, looking at what is actually happening in two jurisdictions that I chose, the US and the EU, and what I found was a spectrum. And then I looked at one theoretical perspective of legal theory and the concept of ideas, and what I found there was a prism, so I'll elaborate on that in the following. So in the pragmatic perspective, I wanted to look at two things. First of all, what is happening in practice? And the second aspect was some pragmatic theorizing, as I called it. Pragmatic here is, what I mean by it is an approach that is grounded in reality and in reasonableness. Looking to the US experience, but I have to stress that I'm an EU lawyer, I found a very pertinent comment something that the US Supreme Court said in Brown Shoe in the 60s. Congress prescribed a pragmatic, factual approach to the definition of the relevant market, not a formal legalistic one. And I think that still holds true for the US today. The US agencies have had a more than 100-year-long relationship of lawyers and economists working together on competition law cases and also on market definition. They introduced, as we all know, the famous SNP test in the 80s, and they're relying on economic arguments to arrive at the relevant market. How does that differ in the EU? Definitely in its history, so the EU experience is much shorter. It also started much later with introducing economic arguments into market definition. The EU market definition notice only dates from 1997, which introduced the SNP test. But I argue that today's status quo is not so very different from the US status quo. However, I do need to say that our European Commission, the main enforcer of EU competition law on the EU level, only has 28 economists in its chief economist team. So that is a big difference in practice. And we only established a chief economist team in 2003. So if you then follow me in arguing that we find a spectrum between law and economics, then you can say along that spectrum of how market definition is used, you can put several dots of where you find authorities or courts to be. And what I found is more that the authorities on both sides of the Atlantic are more in the blue area, the economics area, and US courts probably more in the middle balance between legal and economic arguments. And the EU courts, perhaps more legalistic, but at the same time, I'd like to point to the general court, which said in Italian Glass that it's actually for the commission to bring the market definition, and it shouldn't supplant those arguments. So much for the pragmatic perspective in action. And then I turned to some pragmatic theorizing. And I found that the pragmatic approach will allow you to overcome some formalistic hurdles, so to speak, by just accepting reality as it is. And then, as de Sattelstein said, wielding economic arguments where they fit. And Judge Posner said a number of years ago, American legal theory is pragmatic, the European is more formalistic, Well, I argue now, 14 years on, this might actually have changed quite a bit. So here, this is what I understand as being the spectrum where you can move between law and economic arguments. And your position can change. It's not carved in stone. What I did then is move to the theoretical perspective of legal theory, which finds that law consists of rules and norms, but also of concepts. And the concept of the relevant market is one of those concepts. There can be different levels of abstraction. I don't have time to go into that in any detail. But what I found is that economic concepts such as a market, when taken up by the law, takes on its own specific legal meaning. So it does have an economic origin. I'm sure we can all agree on that. But taken up by the law, it gains a different conception. That's also what I found when looking at conceptual history, that concepts they contain condensed experience. They tell us a lot more than first meets the eye, but at the same time, there's great variety. Geographically speaking, we do not necessarily need to understand a concept the same way in the EU as in the US and vice versa. And time-sensitive differences. If you think of the long history of lawyers and economists working together in the US compared to the EU, there's also a time difference here. And then when we incorporate the economic market concept into the law, it takes on its own conception, as I said. The concept of the market in economics is not equal to the legal concept of the relevant market in competition law. However, it's a shared concept, it's got the same roots, but today it has a distinct conception as here as I posture. And so this I understand to be a prism. We look at the market, the relevant market, through the prism of the law, but we also end up with a different kind of spectrum than the first one that we looked at before. I then conclude with the two principal roles of economics in competition law. And here we have the normative role and an interpretive one. The normative role understands concepts and categories drawn from economic science to become operative standards of the legal system. So economics become the law, and they can answer questions of law under that normative perspective. And here, if you think of the spectrum, that's definitely leading towards the economic side of the spectrum. On the other hand, if you think of the prism, that's more an interpretive role for economics. One Austrian scholar said, law has to ask questions from the normative perspective. Economics can only help us in answering factual questions. So it's pertaining to questions of fact. While the law draws on economics, it ultimately relies on an autonomous concept of the relevant market. What does that leave us with? I think it has implications for how we analyze cases. Also, practically speaking, I think, although I'm a non-practicing lawyer, whether we believe in a spectrum to be the correct approach, or perhaps a prism, whether we have the law as a prism in the middle or not, and if we agree that we might have to rely more on a prism approach, then this, in the end, although I started this academic exercise by thinking of market definition, it has repercussions on any economic concept that competition law and any other area of the law has taken up, such as market power, or what does collusion mean, what is passing on, and so on. Then you might ask, well, what is the benefit of all this? Perhaps more analytical clarity. Because market definition is not an aim in itself, we need to understand how it's built and what it's good for. But here, what I'd like to caution is also, even if we start looking at market definition and other economic concepts more through the prism and hope to gain more legal certainty, this might be a bit misleading, because we're still left with a spectrum, and legal interpretation, as all lawyers know, can also lead to uncertainty and is quite flexible in itself.
Thank you. Marina?
Thank you. Thank you. I enjoyed Vicky's paper, and I appreciate the opportunity to read and comment on it. She's identified an important issue in competition law. Obviously, as we all know, the outcome of many antitrust cases turn on market definition, to the point where market definition is often outcome determinative. And what Vicky does is she discusses how it should be conceptualized in terms of its connection to law and economics. Vicky's, I guess, general thesis is that market definition should be viewed theoretically through the lens of the law as a legal concept that's merely informed by economics. And that under this approach, economics would have an interpretive and a more subordinate role, although there would still be room for variation on the importance of economics, depending on how abstract and how concrete the legal concept in question, how concrete it is. So I guess, first of all, let me say that I agree with Vicky's general proposition that economics should only inform competition law and shouldn't provide the ultimate answers. And I share her view, I think it's implicit in her paper, probably not explicit, that antitrust law isn't a branch of applied economics. But I'm a little bit nervous about the paper's positioning of market definition as a legal concept. I think market definition is more an analytical tool and not an end in itself. And I wonder if characterizing it as a legal concept would elevate it to a legal requirement, which has to be formally proven in all except per se cases. As someone who values antitrust enforcement, strong antitrust enforcement, the thought that it could do so makes me a bit nervous. So my thinking is that at least in the US, despite the importance of market definition, it's not really a legal element, even in merger analysis. I recognize that no court, it goes way back to Brown-Shoe, no court has ever dispensed with the need to define the market. But even so, Section 7 only speaks in terms of evaluating competition effects in any line of commerce, which doesn't exactly equate to market definition. And the 2010 guidelines, merger guidelines, explicitly refer to market definition as an analytical tool, albeit a very important one, among other analytical tools for predicting competition effects of a merger. And in non-merger cases, I think there's even more recognition that market definition is not an end in itself. It's important only because it allows us to calculate market shares and to infer market power from market share data. And in Section 1 cases, for instance, I think Indiana Federation of Dentists and maybe other cases have said, perhaps in dicta, that market power is just a proxy for anti-competitive effects, and so it wouldn't have to be proven if anti-competitive effects can be directly established. Even for Section 2, Microsoft, and again maybe other cases, have suggested that if there's direct proof of market power, indirect proof through market definition and market share calculations wouldn't be necessary. And if it were not for my concern that characterizing market definition as a legal concept would further enhance its importance, I probably would not have raised this, because I do understand that it's a very major part of Vicky's paper. So, but I think it could make antitrust enforcement more difficult. Another thought and question I have relates to how, in practice, the proposed PRISM approach would actually clarify analysis or reach a different outcome than the current spectrum approach. So it's a little bit abstract, and as a theoretical paper, it has to be abstract, but I sort of like it to be a little bit concrete, to give some substance to it. So let's look at how the U.S. approaches market definition in practice. Courts have long defined markets in terms of demand substitution, which products buyers view as acceptable alternatives, cellophane case, right? So this corresponds to cross-elasticity of demand between products in economic terms. And then the merger guidelines have set forth a seemingly more precise metric, the hypothetical, the famous hypothetical monopolist SNP test. right, to determine whether alternative products are acceptable enough from the buyer's perspective to serve as a competitive constraint. But in reality, it's often not, there's often not enough quantitative evidence to operationalize the SNP test. For instance, there isn't the cost information for multiple products that's needed to estimate demand elasticities. So in practice, qualitative evidence is often offered in addition to or instead of quantitative evidence. So the qualitative evidence could include even anecdotal evidence, market executives' testimony as to what buyers did after a previous price increase, informal buyer surveys, evidence relating to industry participants' behavior, such as which firms and which products do they monitor, whose price changes do they respond to, and so forth. And it also may include industry experts, the views of industry experts as to which products they see as likely alternatives for buyers. So these are some of the types of qualitative evidence that U.S. enforcement agencies turn to make their cases on market definition, market power, and effects. So, and I would describe what is being done as competition law, taking the economic concept of cross-elasticity of demand and making it its own by not insisting on quantitative evidence which is not there or which is not reliable, and instead figuring out and using appropriate qualitative evidence to answer the ultimate legal question of, say, the competition effects of a merger. But if this is termed the pragmatic approach, which Vicky does, then how would the PRISM approach actually change the analysis or the outcome? So maybe the lines are a bit blurry. So I think I'd like some less abstract telling me what the difference would be in the analysis, how it would clarify the analysis.
Marina,
so to me, it doesn't seem that different from the PRISM approach. And I'm wondering if the nuances could be brought up a little bit. So finally, I'm going to just bring one last thought or question, which is sort of related. And I'd like to ask Vicky, does the interpretive role for economics under the PRISM approach allow for economic insights to change the law if the law finds the economic insights to be persuasive? Or would you consider that economics assuming a normative role? So for instance, there's been a wave of economic literature in the last few years saying that economics do not support the drawing of hard boundaries to define the market. Right. Now, none of this is really novel to antitrust lawyers. Many of us have felt for years that the way that we define markets, either a product is all in or is all out, is flawed. Right. But now my question is this. With economic studies supporting our intuitive insights, would it be consistent with the proposed PRISM approach for competition law to find a way to perhaps not use hard boundaries, or would that be viewed as economics exceeding an interpretive role and assuming a normative one? Thank you.
Thank you. So I'm afraid we're getting a little short on time, so we might go to the next paper if Anne is ready. And while she's getting her set up, I'll just make two very, very quick comments, about market definitions, obviously, a really important point for, especially in transactions, in terms of, as Marina said, they can be outcome determinative. I found the discussion of the different approaches that were being taken as to legalistic versus more economic as between different institutions was quite interesting. I thought you also could observe, though, the different roles that those institutions have. So, for example, in the US, the court is actually where the decision is being made as to whether a transaction violates our antitrust laws or doesn't. In Europe, the Commission makes that decision, and then the court is really only there as an appellate kind of body. So that's why there's so much deference being paid to the actual factual findings that the Commission makes. So I thought that was something worth adding. But I did think that you did a really good job of acknowledging the difficulty. I mean, economics isn't, single result objective. There are different economic views, and that's why you get, that's why we have cases. You have the government's economist and you have the party's economist, and they have different views. So it's not like economics is going to give you the answer whether we rely on it as an interpretive tool or the actual means to the end. So I like that part of the paper. So over to Anne.
Thank you very much. I am going to talk about European Union competition law. I'm more specific. Is it not on? Okay, so European Union competition law, and more specifically the use of legal presumptions in the enforcement of Article 101 TFEU. Now, some background information. Article 101 is one of three provisions of EU competition law. It prohibits anti-competitive agreements and is basically the EU equivalent of Section 1 of the Sherman Act. We've also got Article 102, which prohibits the abuse of dominance, which is very roughly the EU equivalent of Section 2. And then we've got the EU merger regulation, which, as the name suggests, sets up the system of EU merger control. Now, the wording of these provisions has not changed significantly since their enactment, but their interpretation has. So over the last 20 years, the interpretation of these three rules has undergone significant changes. The European Commission, which is the EU's main enforcement body, in the late 1990s embarked on a process of rethinking key concepts of EU antitrust law. And it was responding to criticism that EU competition law was out of touch with economic theory and too reliant on form-based presumptions of legality and illegality. The European Commission embarked on this process and really made significant changes. This was an extended and quite complex soul-searching process, and the outcome of this process has become known as the so-called more economic approach. This did not happen by recasting the prohibition provisions, but by changing the interpretation. And the European Commission spelled out this revised interpretation in guidelines and other soft law instruments. I think the more economic approach can be summarized as being based on four key principles. First, it narrowed down the legal objective of EU competition law. According to the more economic approach, the primary purpose of EU competition law now is the enhancement of consumer welfare. The Commission's previous understanding had been much broader and had focused very heavily on aims such as protecting economic freedom and fairness. Secondly, on the basis of this narrower legal objective, the Commission also narrowed down the concept of harm. Whereas it had previously equated restrictions of competition with restrictions of economic freedom, it now only considers such restrictions of economic freedom problematic that result in consumer harm. Thirdly, it reduced the type of effect that is deemed capable of offsetting anti-competitive effects to efficiency effects only. And lastly, the more economic approach rejects the over-reliance on form-based presumptions of legality and illegality and favours individual assessments of the actual effects. And it's this last point that I'm going to be focusing on, the rejection of form-based presumptions. My research question was, how has this theoretical commitment to scaling back the use of legal presumptions worked out in practice? Now, if we look at the enforcement of Articles 102 in the merger regulation, I'd say that there has been a lot of change. That has become a lot more effects-based. However, with regard to Article 101, the picture is very, very different, and that's the provision I'm going to be focusing on. Now, the wording of Article 101 is wonderfully convoluted, but in essence, it boils down to the following. The provision prohibits agreements between undertakings that may affect trade between the member states of the European Union and that have the object or effect of restricting competition. It's the words object and effect that are relevant in this context. Now, according to the European Court of Justice, a restriction by object is a restriction of competition that is so likely to have negative effects that it would be redundant to carry out an analysis of the actual effects, meaning that, as a consequence, the anti-competitive effects are presumed. Agreements that do not have the object of restricting competition need to be assessed as to their actual effects. So Article 101 at least as interpreted by the European Court of Justice, contains the inbuilt recognition that in some cases the anti-competitive effects may be presumed, and that in other less obvious cases we have to look a little more closely. That is not so different from the distinction between per se illegality and rule of reason under Section 1 of the Sherman Act. Now, after the more economic approach was introduced, I think one could have expected the Commission to rely less on object restrictions and more on restrictions by effect. Actually, the contrary is true. If we look at the decision factors since 2005, we see that the Commission has prohibited a total of 78 agreements, of which 72 were pure object cases, no assessment of the effects at all. One single case has been exclusively assessed as to its effects on competition, and then there were five of what I call mixed cases, where the Commission says, well, this is an object restriction, but just for the sake of completeness and because we can, we're going to prove the effects anyway. So I think that's a really puzzling finding, given how much talk there had been about scaling back the use of form bias-based presumptions. So how to explain this? Well, if we read these 78 decisions, which unfortunately I've done, I'd say that this is clearly not the result of a change of interpretation. So the Commission has not actually increased the number of agreements that it considers restricted by object. This is purely the result of case selection. In practice, the Commission has not been enforcing Article 101 against cases that do not fit the object box since 2005. Well, that raises the next question, why? Why this case selection? I've explored a number of factors, which I can't go into in this time frame, but I think the most important and the most likely factor is going to be cost considerations. It is much, much more expensive to prove the effects on competition than it is just to infer them from the agreements form, especially since the European Commission introduced the welfare-based approach to competitive harm. It now not only has to show that the agreement restricts competition, but it also has to prove that this restriction of competition caused a tangible reduction in consumer welfare. And if you do that on the basis of empirical, convincing evidence, and you throw in a couple of quantitative studies, that is a lot more elaborate than just inferring the anti-competitive effects from the form of the agreement. So somewhat paradoxically, I think, the Commission's desire to do the economically correct thing and to assess the effects on consumer welfare and to do so in a state-of-the-art economic analysis has led to the Commission just not enforcing Article 101 against these cases anymore. Last question is, does it matter? Is this a reason for concern? And I think the answer is yes. I've examined a couple of alternative forms of enforcement, namely private enforcement, enforcement by three national competition agencies, namely that of the UK, Germany, and France. And I've looked at commitments decision and found the exact same picture. All of these cases almost exclusively also concerned object cases, which means that in practice, Article 101 is not being enforced against agreements that merely have the agreement, the effect of restricting competition. And I think that's worrying because agreements that have the effect of restricting competition are not necessarily less dangerous to competition than object cases, they're just less obvious. The degree of harm does not enter into this definition at all. The very last question, I promise, I asked myself, isn't this just a very efficient use of limited resources? The Public Enforcement Authority has a limited budget, so does it not make sense for this authority to focus on the easier and cheaper cases and see through multiple object cases instead of one effect case? So I'd say in the short term, maybe, but in the long term, it is not, because I'm worried about the message this sends out to companies. If businesses know that Article 101 is no longer being enforced against anything that does not fit the object box, well, what's stopping them then from engaging in that kind of conduct? I think not very much. Right? So in conclusion, I would like to see the European Commission and the National Competition Authority review their current practice of case selection and not exclusively focus on object cases. if we're serious about prohibiting agreements that merely have the effect of restricted competition, then I think we need to enforce the provision at least from time to time to keep businesses on their toes, because otherwise this rule risks becoming a dead letter. Thank you very much.
Thank you, that's great. Anu.
Thank you. First of all, I want to congratulate Anne for an excellent paper. I think it is a topic that we all care about, whether you care about it in the European context or beyond. In many ways, I think you are underselling the paper, its significance, when we think about the implications that it has. So for me, one of the most exciting ways to read the paper was to think about it as a lens for a broader question of whether there exists a gap between law in books and law in action and the philosophy as it's pronounced and the philosophy as it's actually practiced. And if it's something that we don't expect EU to do well, that it tells that it moves towards more economic approach, how do we expect many other jurisdictions that have followed the EU's model to do it in any other way? So overall, I think it's a persuasive paper. At first sight, it seems counterintuitive. Then, because of the persuasive explanations that you give, I think it seems actually less counterintuitive to me in the end. But overall, I think it's a valuable contribution on issue that we deeply care about. But in the interest of hopefully improving the paper or helping you when you build your work on this, so let me focus on some issues where I would like you to probably think through the issues a little bit more. And first, I want to focus on the empirical claims that you make, and then on the explanations that you give for the phenomenon, and finally, return to the question, how much does this matter? Should we really care about this? So empirically, I was somewhat struggling with your continuing repeated referrals of the case selection. And I don't know whether you can really claim that the Commission is choosing different kinds of cases. So if you look at the page 11 and the statistics that you show, I think the comparison is something that was a little bit less persuasive for me when you compare the 1985 to 1997 case selection to 2005 to 2017. There's a big gap in between there. I think a lot has changed in the enforcement environment that explains for the differential outcomes. If you think about the few cartel cases that we saw back then, I think it's partially explained by the lack of the same investigative tools. I don't know whether Dawn rates were used, and at that time, leniency program wasn't in place, so I think there's a lot of confounding variables that explain what was going on. In general, the biggest problem when you look at this empirically is that we really don't know the denominator. Unlike at least in the merger control cases, when we have the notifications, we have a baseline. We don't have that in the case of Article 101. Even with the mergers, we could say that there's a selection effect, and we don't exactly know what kind of mergers are coming forward because of the anticipation of the enforcement. But I think doing anything empirical in the 101 setting is all the more complicated. Your striking bar graph, I think it is to a large extent explained by using the horizontal and the vertical cases as part of the same comparison. I think the dynamics underlying the cartel and vertical cases are radically different, and I wouldn't be surprised that cartels are an enforcement priority and the cartels don't require effects tests but are generally treated as a per se obligations. Few of us are terribly worried about that development. So it really leaves you with 10 cases, and it's a very small end to try to then tease out what is going on. So I guess that's sort of one of the worries that I had there. But then more conceptually, I'm wondering whether you can defend this binary thinking that the cases are either object or effect cases, even in your own discussion, which I think you do really skillfully, is you show that sometimes the Commission does not even choose whether it calls something an object or an effect case. It mentions that we look at this by object, yet it goes on to examine the effects. So it seems like there's a continuum rather than a really binary, easy to categorize way to look at this. So that's probably where I want to push you a little bit on the empirical front. Then in terms of your explanations, so I'm curious whether this is something that you only detect as a policy implemented by the Commission. or if this is something that might have changed also the ways the parties are arguing the cases. So I don't know whether you've had any conversations or conducted interviews, had a chance to review any submissions or complaints, whether the parties putting these complaints forward or arguing the cases, interacting with the commission, are they pushing the commission for more effects base, yet the commission is pushing back? Or are they also arguing the cases more in terms of the object? So that's one question that would help you probably get to the explanation how much it is the commission's own intervention or a general way to think about the cases. I really like your case studies into UK, France, and Germany. I think it's fascinating that they follow the same trend. I think that would give you some analytical leverage to analyze which reasons for this trend are likely to be more prevalent. It doesn't seem to be commission specific, but something that penetrates the legal system more broadly, including in the member states. And then finally, when we think about the explanation, so what gave me some pause and I was trying to think about is that you seem to concede, and I think rightly so, that the Commission has adopted more effects-based analysis and economic thinking in the case of Article 102. But why not then in Article 101? It is the same institution, and even if there are, when there are different case teams and different set of civil servants looking at the 101 or 102 cases, wouldn't the 101 teams and the economists within the 101 teams defend their turf and the kind of analysis that they would like to see conducted in a 101? And why would the 102 enforcement then follow somewhat of a different pattern? Do you see some evidence that resource has been shifted, the resources are taken away from 101 cases to 102 cases? Do we see more of an economist working on those cases? That I think some kind of a qualitative study that, in my experience, incredibly transparent commission could help you answer. The length of the cases doesn't suggest that they are all about saving resources. On the other hand, it could just be that it's easier to copy-paste part of the submissions and the length is a little tricky to measure empirically, but that's also something that I like to think about in the explanation section. So let me now finish then with the third question is, how much this matters? What is the harm and whether I should lose sleep over what I found here? And in many ways, I think there's the explanation that you offered that to me is most persuasive is what you call the filter function, that in many ways the analysis based on the effects is happening prior to the investigation and leads the commission to drop those cases and not to pursue them at all. Is this a problem? Do you have some evidence on false negatives, the cases that really should have been pursued but just gets dropped earlier, complaints that don't lead to opening to the case? Is there conversation or acknowledgement of this kind of trend taking place? Or if that's not the case, is there still a cost that we should worry about? For instance, the idea that there's no decision, so we have less transparency on the kind of thinking that we see, the way that we ask the commission to justify even the merger cases where it does clear the merger in the first phase. But back to the resource question, is this how we want the commission to spend resources? Would we want it to spell out every time that the effects case doesn't really need to lead to that many concerns? I do not know. So in cases, I think, where I think the paper would be stronger if you were able to show some kind of a case that either the object reasoning leads us to cases where there are no anti-competitive effects, so there is a formalism that is actually working against us, or to the kind of cases that where anti-competitive effect never gets detected because they do not get to the formal radar of the commission. So then sort of two more maybe suggestions on whether this matters is that if you assume then that there is harm, what are the kind of cases that you think that fall off the radar and that we are missing? So you talk about either coordination or foreclosure cases. Do you have a hypothesis that one or the other is more likely to be subject to effects analysis and we would not see that kind of harm? So should we be more worried about foreclosure or the coordination types of harm that does not get detected through the object cases and then would not get as much attention by the commission? And my final question is that in many ways, I think what we see the Commission do in practice is not that different from what it says in the guidelines. In terms of the cartel cases are, I think, rightly often treated almost exclusively as object cases. So if that is right, should we actually, would you propose that we revisit the categories of what should be considered harmful based on object or effect? Or should we actually drop the object case altogether and force the Commission to always justify the effect? Which takes us back to the question of, is this really the most efficient use of resources? So those are some of the questions that I had for you. But overall, let me just go back to where I started. I think it's an incredibly valuable question and question that will teach all of us a great deal. So I'm really glad that you're pursuing this.
Thank you. I can't get my microphone to work, but can we go 5 minutes over because we started so late?
Sure.
Great. So 5 minutes for Alanna and then to Rachel.
I'll try and be very quick because I agree with most of the comments that Anu made. I think the real question is, and it was asked by Anne in the very beginning, does it matter? So what are the outcomes of the objects and effects cases and are they different? Are there examples of either unprosecuted effects cases or object cases that have been lost by the Commission that have had negative market effects? Because if you can't establish that, then what you can establish is that there's really a reason to pursue it that way. I would argue that, and as Anu said, if it's a cartel case, that's sort of an obvious thing. If you're stopping it as an effect, as an object case before you see the effects, and it's a rebuttable presumption, and the other side did not present a credible rebuttable presumption, then you've already answered your own question. And then you said you've seen a lot of changes in the 102 analysis, which means that maybe some of your effects cases are getting addressed there to the extent that they're not addressed within sort of an obvious contractual issue at stake. So that's a question that I would want answered to really get to the conclusion you draw that there's something wrong about the way 101 cases are being prosecuted. I do think you answered the question that needs to constantly be asked in antitrust law, which is the tension between economics and law and how we look at these issues. And that's prevalent in Viktoria's paper as well. You know, people like me who are antitrust trial lawyers like to think of ourselves as economists on the side. I know economists would actually disagree with that description, but we like to think we're experts in everything. But it's so the constant tension we have is we set up these frameworks in antitrust law and that guide our legal thinking about them, but they're not just legal frameworks. We base them on economic principle, and so I'm constantly struggling both, you know, in talking to economists sometimes, but when I read academic papers with, okay, you're telling me I'm only looking at this through a legal framework, but why am I wrong? How is the economics any different from the legal framework? And this is a central tension that I often see in both discussions with economists and in academic papers that I think, you know, it's a thread that runs through Viktoria's paper, it's a thread that runs through your paper, and others that we're not discussing here today. And so that's essentially it, because I knew basically took all the really good and sexy comments.
Okay. Rachel.
Well, let me just round up briefly and also thank NYU and the ABA and the authors of the three papers for the opportunity for me to come today and to read three very interesting and thought-provoking papers, which, if you take them together, they really do illustrate how global antitrust has become and how, you know, it's not just the practitioner world, it's not just the agency world. Very importantly, it's also the academic world looking at these different issues, not necessarily agreeing and not necessarily coming to the same analysis or the same results, because as we all know, the context, economic, legal, political, social is part and parcel of what we're doing as well. So I thought that Wendy's paper is really a very valuable paper, particularly for those of us that don't have access to anything that is in Mandarin, me for starters, to help us understand the role of the AML, not only in terms of its creation, but also in terms of its involving enforcement in China. As you say, Wendy, China transitions from a command economy to a market-based economy. Two further suggestions on top of Frank's, if I may. One is from a slightly different perspective. I would ask you to reconsider whether you actually want to make any comparative comments in the paper about the US and the EU and Germany. I think you do it twice in the paper. I think they may distract for the, I loved your phrase, Frank, the mission, missionary zeal of those that want, readers that want to improve competition law. I think what your main message is that is that China is sui generis, and maybe continue down that message. My other suggestion, Frank was suggesting another paper you might write. I would suggest a different paper you might write, as well as the excellent paper you have written. And you might consider, because I think this, your messages are so important for business and practitioners, really to understand the context that China is working in, that you might consider at some stage a paper for that community, and possibly, given that its attention span is not great, a shorter paper so that it really gets read. That's not a criticism of your paper, but I just know a lot of that community won't get beyond a few pages. Anne's paper on the effect of the status of Article 101 enforcement, the effect of enlargement on the EU, the effect of decentralization of enforcement to sharing enforcement with member states. I also found extremely interesting, and particularly the work you've done looking at three of the current, I have the stress on current, member states, France, Germany, and the EU. Of course, a lot of enforcement now at 101 and 102 does take place at member state level rather than at the EU. If you were able to expand that at any stage, that would be great. Anu has put very eloquently a number of the points that I was going to raise as well. I'm still a bit mystified by the pattern that you're finding. And I'm wondering whether, as well as all the factors that Anu mentioned, possibly the agencies are also having a mind to whether their decisions are, to use a US term, litigation proof. I mean that, you know, there is the risk of not litigation, but appeal. Yeah. So you go for the easier cases. In fact, your paper made me really stop and think about one case that I was very involved with whilst I was a DOJ special advisor. And then I realized I couldn't remember whether it was an object or an effects case. I actually think it's both, but it's written, and I'm not going to identify which one it was, it's written as an object case. But again, you know, what do we really mean by all of that? And Vicky's paper, I must actually just give you one quote from Anne's paper, this stage in the afternoon. Fairly near the beginning of her paper, she makes a reference to the usual rational world of competition lawyers. I loved your quote. It got me chuckling as I went through the rest of your paper.
I like the bit about the patient being in critical condition.
Exactly, exactly. Vicky's paper is a very, I know you didn't intend it to be Vicky, but actually it's a very nice bridge between Anne's paper and Wendy's paper. The relationship between law and economics is relevant in both the jurisdictions that the other two papers looked at, and of course more widely. If I'm really honest, I have to say this was the hardest paper for me to get through, and I think that perhaps as you revisit it, you might like to consider exactly who the audience is you have in mind for your paper and what knowledge you are assuming of them, and that might help those of us that are perhaps not so familiar with some of the theory that you were thinking about. But your basic tenet and the importance from a practical point of view of the relationship between law and economics, and how, whether it's from an agency perspective or a private practice perspective, the need for the two really to work together, not side by side or in parallel, but really, certainly from a practical point of view, working together to formulate a case, whether you're presenting to the agency or defending an agency, and as you were saying, Alama, asking, if one's coming from the legal point of view, asking the economist, please, to speak in a way that I can understand as a lawyer, and then hopefully the judge will understand as well, I think is important. I think your very interesting analysis is complicated also by the really somewhat divergent view that of life that we have from the European Commission on the one hand and the court still in Europe on another hand. So you've got a lot of different dimensions of what you're doing there. But just to finish off, I mean, great examples of the global aspects of competition law. And thank you so much for the opportunity to read them and participate today.
Do we have any questions from the audience?
Great question. Hi. Is it possible that what we're seeing at the Commission is greater emphasis on abuse of dominance cases, which are very resource intensive? And maybe there is some conscious decision there to work on the object cases. Because if you look at US, DOJ, and FTC, it's not like there's a lot of Section 1 rule or recent cases brought here at all. Maybe a few more at the FTC, very rare at DOJ. And Section 2 cases are pretty non-existent here too. So I just wondered if what you're seeing actually is by looking at, looking under the lamppost at the 101 cases, what you're seeing is that the emphasis has shifted.
There's three mics on. If somebody turns off one of their mics, that will come on.
Well, I think one possible explanation is that there are so much fewer Article 102 cases. So the 78, I mean, statistically speaking, the Commission pursues many, many more 101 cases. So I think when they do a 102 case, which are relatively rare, not as rare as in the US, but I think they can afford to put more resources into doing that properly. I think the second reason is that it is in particular the previous practice on Article 102, which had been deemed too formalistic, that had really been subject to criticism. So I think they really upped their game on that one and really made an effort. If we just think about Microsoft and the criticism that the Commission was exposed to for not having assessed the effects of consumer welfare, for example. So Article 102 was the one to fix, I think, and they
put
a lot of effort into doing that.
So first, I think in Microsoft there was a lot of stuff in the Commission's opinion about economic effect. So I'm not sure. The reason why I raised my hand was I wonder if you looked at the trend of decisions against the level of penalties. So one theory for how enforcement agencies may operate is that they are sensitive. How much money they can get back. So penalties in one of two cases have gone, shall we say, through not even a roof, sky, up to the sky, I don't know. But 101, I think there's been a change in the way the penalty structure has been, maybe over the time, I'm not sure of the dates, maybe over the time that you've studied, but I think it would be interesting to, you know, to think about that as a theory for how cases get brought. Obviously, these are easier to win. That's a good reason to bring the case. Besides being less, not so much less expensive to litigate, but sure to win if you have to go to the courts, and you'll make more money out of it. So, just
yes,
a thought about.
I totally agree. That's in the paper. I did not kind to discuss that. I said that I suspect that the object cases are particularly attractive because they're pretty appeal proof on that point at least.
But the money, as they say, follow the money.
Well, I just want to thank all of our paper writers, the excellent, three excellent papers, and the